Thank you, Partha, and hi everybody. It's great to be here for the second year in a row. I'm Liz Perraudin, Senior Policy Officer here at Diabetes UK and Policy Lead for all things digital health and technology, hence why I am with you today. I've been asked today to talk about the future of diabetes technology and really to share some reflections with you on how bright the future really is for us, for people living with diabetes and the technology that they use. I'll cover a couple of things today, and actually what I'll start with is looking backwards rather than to the future to really set the scene of just how far we've come in recent times. I'll talk to you a bit about some of the exciting developments that are in the pipeline that we've seen more recently and that we hope will be coming. Some of the things we really do want to see in the future and aren't quite with us yet. And also thinking about how we get there. What do we need to get ourselves to a point where diabetes technology is better, frankly, than it is now. So to start with, thinking about how far we've come. Well, Diabetes UK is incredibly proud of the impact we've had and the research we've funded looking into all things diabetes technology. And here you see in 1983, the first ever insulin pen launched after a trial supported by Diabetes UK. Back in the 70s, injecting insulin, as some people here will remember, involved glass syringes and steel needles that had to be sharpened and reused. And the incredible doctor Sheila Reith designed a new device to make injections easier, a device which could inject with a single push of a button, revolutionary at the time. And we're thrilled that, now we're actually moving into a space where these type of pens have just got so much better, and now we're seeing smart pens emerge, including smart pens with kind of integrations with CGM and apps, etc. Likewise, in 1987, our funding helped this man, Professor Anthony Turner, to pioneer a new kind of sensor technology, first ever handheld blood glucose meter, exact tech, I think it was called. And this is something you'll all be incredibly familiar with now, but when you think it was just 1987 when the first one of these became kind of routinely available in the UK. And moving us actually even further backwards, in 1977, Diabetes UK purchased the UK's first artificial pancreas. It was the size of a filing cabinet, and I wasn't sure if I was allowed to use the image, but if you search first ever artificial pancreas on Google, you will see an image of it, and it is safe to say it wouldn't have been easy to carry around with you. But since then, we've continued to back research into closed loop technology, including supporting and funding some work that Professor Roman Havorka did to develop his artificial pancreas technology, CAM-APS, and also some work that Professor Helen Murphy has done around the use of hybrid closed loop technology in pregnancy. All of this has been hugely exciting, and with the recent kind of launch of a pilot within the NHS looking at the use and development of data around the use of hybrid closed loop technology in a real world setting, it is incredible to think how far we've come. But there are more exciting developments and happening at a much more rapid pace. Wearable glucose monitors are getting better and better. We've got the Dexcom 7, the Libre 3 coming to us very shortly. We're seeing ever improving algorithms for closed loop technology, for artificial pancreas technology, that will make the technology more fine-tuned, really better responsive to the needs of the individual using it. We also know there is research going into kind of artificial pancreas technology that not only delivers insulin, but also delivers glucagon when required. For those people who use an artificial hybrid closed loop technology or who use an insulin pump for that matter, you know that there are times when it's just not possible to avoid a hypo because the insulin is already in your system. This would allow, it has the potential to allow that to be, that risk to be near completely removed. I also want to touch on other remote monitoring technologies that we're seeing emerge at the moment. So we often think when we think about diabetes technology in terms of glucose monitoring and insulin delivery. But actually, we've seen over the last year some significant progress, for example, in a kidney function urine test that actually can be done at home, and it turns your smartphone into a kidney function test. It's interesting because that's one of the least completed kind of monitoring, or one of the 15 healthcare essentials that people do with type 1 diabetes. And the fact that there's an option emerging for doing this at home might help to ensure that more people are doing this test, which is so essential to the long-term care and management of diabetes. We've also seen some exciting developments around and sort of in the pipeline, things around technologies that can be worn in shoes that can help to predict or identify when there might be a risk of the development of a foot ulcer, for example. All of this is being looked into, is being researched, it's in the pipeline. And when you look at the speed at which technology has improved in recent years, it feels like there's, you know, a lot more to come, and many of us will see the benefit of that in the real not too distant future. I've touched on smart pens already, so I won't dwell on that too much. But I do think it's important to recognise that while we celebrate the incredible kind of lives that diabetes technology allow us to live, for some people, an insulin pump just isn't what they want. It isn't practical for them. They don't want to use one. So having a smart pen that includes kind of bolus calculators and can map with CGM or flash data, for example, offers people who don't want an insulin pump a really great alternative that can allow them to better control, better manage their diabetes in a way that works for them. So, what do we need to get there? You know, I've talked about how actually exciting some of the developments we're seeing are and how the future is bright. But for these technologies to continue to progress at the pace and develop at the pace they have been, there are a few things we do need to achieve to get there. Better access to and use of data. Our health data is what allows algorithms in the artificial pancreas to be so smart, to be so good. But that data needs to be better linked up. So data from somebody's GP and hospital and their remote monitoring technologies, etc. If you can link all of that data together, it will allow for a richer picture and for the algorithms to get better as a result. I appreciate it's slightly odd to talk about insulin at a technology-related conference, but one of my personal biggest bugbears is that insulin is too slow. We need faster, better insulins so that when you are administering a bolus, or when you are when your algorithm in a hybrid closed loop technology is responding to a high blood sugar, we need insulin that moves quickly, that doesn't take 20 plus minutes to be absorbed and to start working. More broadly, we do need more funding into diabetes research. Diabetes doesn't get the funding it needs and it deserves given the size of the population it impacts. So I think you know, that's something that certainly at Diabetes UK will continue to push for, along with also, of course, continuing to fund research ourselves into life-changing innovations in diabetes care and treatment. When we think about existing technologies, insulin pumps, flash, CGM, we have to recognise that there is an access problem, that many people continue, despite meeting criteria, despite clear evidence that they could benefit from these technologies, many people still struggle to access them. And I do think, you know, we have a mountain to climb to ensure that people are getting access to the right technologies for them at the right time. It's kind of hard to imagine imagine that somebody who isn't even getting access to an insulin pump despite meeting the criteria is going to get access to a hybrid closed loop system immediately. So actually we kind of need to start with the basics a bit and ensure that we're getting it right with the technologies that exist now in order to prepare ourselves and prepare our health system for the exciting technologies that we're going to see in the future. And I also think a kind of final point to touch on really is a better understanding of the barriers to access and use. You know, why do some people not want to use technology? Is it because they find it kind of the kit too big? Is it because they're overwhelmed with the data? And what can we do to address some of those challenges? Equally, we know that certain groups, particularly those from minority ethnic backgrounds and people living in areas of high deprivation, have the lowest use and access to diabetes technology. We need to really understand why that's happening and what we as a policy team at Diabetes UK or PATHA in NHS England or whoever else it might be can do to address and tackle that, because inequities in access and use of diabetes technology exist. It's unacceptable, and we need a really deep, clear understanding of why that's the case so we can seek to address it. So the future is bright. I hope that some of what I've talked about has really given you hope for the kinds of things that are in the pipeline and that many of us will see in our lives with diabetes. I must admit, as somebody living with type 1 diabetes, and somebody who has the privilege of seeing some of the things that are coming out and the things that researchers and innovators are developing, it does make me excited. It does make me feel like the future genuinely bright. And what I've put at the bottom of the screen here is just a link through to a page on our website that will show you various research studies that are ongoing. And should they be of interest to you, please do take a look, because you might be able to sign up and support not only yourself getting access to exciting new treatments and new technologies, but also contribute to research that will save lives and improve lives for many thousands of people living with diabetes in the future. So a massive thank you to everyone for listening to me, and have a wonderful rest of your afternoon.
Thank you, Liz. Lovely presentation and lovely summary of what's going on. So thank you. And that brings us to the close of the day. And I think it's time to just say some thank yous. I won't hold you all up much too longer. Sorry, we haven't been able to answer all the questions, but thank you so much for being part of it, sending all the stuff. So we'll start off, obviously, by thanking Diabetes UK themselves, Chris Askew, for all the leadership he provides, Claire Howard for all the work she's done behind the scenes, and a lot of hard work has gone to make this happen. The sponsors themselves, Dexcom, Abbott, Insulet, without whom it wouldn't be available free to everybody today. And the company which has ran all this digitally and kept everything in my ear, making it look much more professional than actually I normally can be, Stream 7. And a quick shout out to Tom, who has been helping us from behind the scenes with all the tips and everything. So speakers, wonderful as ever, some great clinical speakers, but more importantly, those journeys for people, you know, heard the story of Molly and heard the story from Gareth about the daughter, amazing, lovely stories. Pat, so very good overview. Ross about the pregnancy. So overall, some fantastic talks through the day. And thank you again for contributing. So, and I think it's fair to say, whether you are being part of this event, whether you've been a speaker, etc., you undoubtedly would have touched the lives of all others. So just a point that after the event, you'll be sent a survey for your completion. And it's really important you do that, because I think then you can give views. Do you need more time for questions to be answered? Do you need particular topics to be picked? And I think that's the importance that I would like to see the results of it. You know, personally, I work with Diabetes UK, and it was good to see, you know, how did the day go? What did we miss out? What could we have done it longer? And those are the things that we need to look for and make sure we got everything covered. So we have been able to answer a lot of the questions, but there's a couple of questions, which as ever has been about, funnily enough, about my hair and what do I use to keep it shiny. These are secrets. These are trade secrets, which I'm very, very loath to reveal. But, you know, what I can say is that it does help not being stressed. Being relaxed in life, it's, you know, stops you from, at least maintains my hair and, I don't know, keeps it black. So that's all good from that point of view. Finally, I'm going to leave you all with one word because we're talking about technology and Liz mentions about, you know, the bright future. So NICE will be putting out a few things for consultation very soon about the position of, you know, glucose monitoring, etc. So keep an eye out for that end of November. That should come out. There, hopefully, fingers crossed, might be a few pleasant surprises for the community. We shall see. We are working on it. So that's pretty much all from me. I have been keeping a cheeky eye as well on the football score, and Liverpool are running away with it, which is brilliant to watch. And so it's a good day. It's Sunday. It's Saturday. They all blend into one. But otherwise, stay safe, keep in touch, and hopefully in the future we can all meet and talk about it. And thank you for being a part, and we shall end the day here. Thank you and take care.